Mr. Blaise Fernandez, President and CEO, Indian Music Industry. Mr. Atul Churamani, MD, Turnkey Music, Private Limited, and Publishing. Mr. KJ Singh, popularly known as the Big Chief, Sound Engineer and Music Producer. May I please request everyone to please join me on stage. The stage is yours, Rishi.
Okay. So one of the primary motives of having this panel is, if you're a filmmaker and you're a small independent filmmaker, how would you source your music and what are the permissions required therein? When you're a part of a large studio, a lot of things are easier. You go to the large record labels of the world. But I would imagine that an independent filmmaker has to chart his or her own course. So I'd like to start with kind of setting the context for the evening. What really is the music industry in India today? And I think Blaise Fernandez, being president and CEO of the Indian music industry, is the ideal person to set that platform, the context, before we go ahead. Blaise.
Thank you. Two opening comments, nothing to do with your question. Kudos to the NFTC team and Vikram. One's a positive comment, so that's the first one. I mean, Film Bazaar is vibrant. You've got the states and a long-cherished dream of ease of doing business. Single window clearance has come to. Second negative comment is, this is Goa. Afternoon is supposed to be siesta. Please factor in that the next time. Thank you. How can I say that? Because I'm a local Goan, I'm a local lad, yeah. Thanks, Kannan. The recorded music industry in India has had three fabulous years of growth rate, 20% plus, but we are still 15th globally with 150 million in terms of revenues. For us to break into the top 10, we'll need to kind of treble this. Just because we've had 20% growth rate for the last 3 years average, statistics sometimes are misleading. We're kind of out of the ICU in the recuperating ward. A couple of negative laws, a couple of negative factors can put us back in the ICU. Look at the area around us. Sri Lanka, a vibrant music industry. Pakistan, some great talent, great artists. Bangladesh, another vibrant music industry. The industries in these three regional, SAARC markets are today dead. They are dead because of A, bad policy, B, lack of cohesion as a unit. What's made the industry survive is the labels, the recorded labels, together have ensured piracy has been circumvented to an extent. And they've kind of stayed united despite all the headwinds. They've stayed united. So I think a huge credit goes to what they've done to keep the industry afloat. In Pakistan, there's no recorded music anymore. In Bangladesh, it's completely wiped off. And in Sri Lanka, I mean, there was an era where Radio Ceylon used to be the number one leading channel for various other political reasons also. But, you know, you've got to kind of keep that in mind. So we are out of the ICU, in recuperation phase. And if things go well, good proper medication, proper care, post-care, we could be in the top 10 market. So if, in a nutshell, this is what the recorded music industry is in India like. Thank you.
Atul, I'd like you to come in here and actually define what are the copyrights that are involved when you look for a piece of music, when a filmmaker in this audience wants to go and look for that piece. Now, we obviously have to understand that there is original music and there's re-recorded music. So take us through both those verticals, which is original as well as re-recording.
So, everyone seems to think that it's very complicated to license music for a film because there is, different stakeholders. I have a sound recording, I have creation. So let's just understand what this business is, okay? So the business is about music that is created by two people. One is a composer One is a lyric writer. These are the two things that have copyright that vests with the publishing business. Then that composition and lyric are recorded and made into a song that we hear. That is done by what we call an artist or a performer. That business is done by the record label. So there are two distinct bodies, the publishers and the music labels, who run different businesses because they deal with different creators. If you consider the artist a creator, he works with a record label. So you've all heard of T-Series and Saregama and Universal and Sony, etc. They sign artists and they release artists. Their business is to deal with artists. They own what is called the sound recording. And then there is the composition and lyrics, which are created by people like Javed Saab, Anu Malik, etc. They are creators. They create the composition and lyrics. And any monies that generate off the songs are paid to them. So there is a definite need to pay the three people who create the three things in music that have copyright: composition, lyrics, and sound recording. So when you, and each segment, publishing, which is the composition, lyrics, and the sound recording, have their own sets of copyrights. That makes up the music business. So the composition and lyrics have essentially six copyrights, and it's no rocket science. You have to record the song, so that's the first copyright. You have to make copies of the song if you want to put it out, so that's the second copyright. There's the sale and distribution. You need to sell the song, you need to put it on all your platforms, etc. The fourth is public performance, when it plays on radio, television, bars, clubs, etc. The fifth is the one that you guys are involved with, that is called synchronization. When you marry the composition and lyrics with a film, any audio visual, so even when you make a music video for a song, you're taking the composition and lyrics and putting it into a film. And then there's the translation and adaptation, where you change the composition or the lyric, or you translate the lyric, etc. So that's your set of copyrights on this side. And with the sound recording, you have to make copies, you have to play it on radio, public, you know, establishments, etc. And you can also put it into another song. So it's called incorporation of a song into a new sound recording, what is called sampling in our business. So you take a sample and you create a new recording. So these are the set of rights that exist under copyright. So when you want to license a piece of music, you are asking, number one, for the synchronization right. Okay? So that is when you marry it with the film. But once you married it with the film, you can't just leave the film there. You have to do more with it. So you're going to sell it and distribute it, maybe on DVDs, etc., in the physical world, which means there is a reproduction right, because you're making copies. And you're putting it out for sale and distribution. And then it'll go on to streaming platforms, onto television, etc., etc., which is the public performance right. So you're asking for a series of copyrights with the composition and lyric. And similarly with the sound recording, if you license the original song, you're dealing with the original sound recording, which also requires you to take a license for those rights. The difference between an original song and a licensed song is that when you're creating, then you are dealing only with the composer, writer, or the publisher. When you're dealing with the original sound recording, you have to go back to the copyright owner, which is normally the music label. Got it?
Very beautiful.
Angrezi mein bola.
KJ, you've been at both ends of the spectrum in terms of the fact that you're a composer, now you have your own record label. Would you feel that the trust factor between the artist and the music label is something that needs work on? You find a lot of artists who turn around and, you know, say, oh, I don't trust my music label. Music labels, in turn, sometimes are not able to trust the artist completely. How does one bridge that gap? And are you seeing that improve over the sands of time?
Yeah. First and foremost, I'm just clearing whatever they said before he asked me that question. I understood nothing of it. It was neither any rag, talam, or any chord structure that I know of. So I don't know what they said. As far as artists are concerned, you have to realize artists are by definition very insecure people. See, they need to, their livelihood depends on this. So they are scared that, you know, whether I'm giving it to the right person, will they exploit me or will they exploit my song? That is always the question. What's going to happen? What Atul very rightly said, they are going to exploit the song in all its derivatives and copyright form. But maybe a lot of times the artists are not clear in the all the copyrights that he mentioned. So they come in from the point of view, I've got a creative composition. I've done this beautiful song. I've written this beautiful thing. Now somebody should pay me and that's about it. And keep paying me from there on because it's my copyrighted work. That's the bottom line that an artist understands.
The check should be in the mail.
The check should be in the mail and it should keep coming regularly. That's what they understand. So yes, there is a lot of insecurity. There is a lot of distrust because I'm sure there have been cases where artists have been taken for a ride and there have been cases vice versa as well, where artists knowingly withdrew signing a contract and stuff like that. So, but over the years, it has been improving and thanks to a lot of legwork done by people in the industry and off late the IPRS, I need to mention that, they have actually come back and generated a lot of confidence in artists. There were a lot of artists I knew who had no idea about IPRS, who had no idea about any of this. But at least now they are aware that they need to become a member somewhere which can guarantee them their rights. A lot of new artists come through us and they say, I have a song, can you put it in a film? Do you know a film director, film producer, whatever, or publisher? Can you put it in a film? So there is a lot of talent. We have coming across all parts of regional as well. But where do they go is the main question. Where do they sell their wares? I think that is what we need to address, a platform where they can say, or the filmmakers in this seminar right now, where do they go and collectively say, okay, who are the guys who have the song with them? Can we pick and choose? And for artists to have a platform saying, here are my wares, like you show films, you show trailers. Can artists come and say, here are my songs and rights, can somebody come and pick it up?
So actually, KJ, just to pick up from there, that's really what the publishing business does, right? And for people who are making films, very often they are in touch with people called music supervisors. Because when Steven Spielberg makes a film, I don't think he actually sits down and listens to a whole bunch of music. He's telling his music supervisor, this is the scene. They give a brief. So music supervision is something which is very advanced in Western markets. It's starting in India. So we've had recent situations of Gully Boy having a music supervisor. Dharma Productions now says they have a music supervisor.
Yeah, I'd like to interrupt. What he's talking about is Ankur Tiwari was the music supervisor on Gully Boy.
Yeah.
So he sat with Zoya and with, you know, the musicians, which is Nazy and Divine. And he kind of he got together these musical talents and created that, a scenario like
actually
that.
Actually, that goes slightly beyond beyond music supervision, because music supervision is normally they license an existing piece of music, right? So that's how the business works globally in 99% of the cases. There will be a brief to a music supervisor saying, hey, listen, here's a film. I need an instrumental piece of a fast sitar. It can be as vague as that.
I'll just chime in here. The concept of music supervisor was there till a few years ago. Then for some reason, the dynamics changed and it's gone, but it's coming back. The music industry, the record music industry and the music ecosystem globally is fragmented. Therefore, WIPO worked with the different governments and have these collection societies. So it's kind of an ease of doing business. So if you go to one collection society, you have one set of rights. You go to another collection society, you have another set of rights. But I think, chiming on your statement, and I think what my co-panelists have said, the dynamic in the creative industry is the same. There are good apples, there are bad apples. Okay, so it can't be painted that all the artists don't trust the labels and all the labels don't trust the artists. It's the dynamic, and it happens be it in the stock market, be it in any kind of field of, you know, walk of life.
Now, I want them to, you know, there are these terminologies that a lot of people get a little thrown off by. So I'd like both of you, Blaze and Atul, you can, you know, take this together. The collection agencies or societies and these bodies, one, of course, the Indian music industry, which you head, the PPL as well as the IPRS, and what are the branches they look at? If you could just explain that, please.
Perfect. So as I said, the Indian music industry is not a collection society. is what globally is termed as a national group. And in any country where there is music and there's recorded music, there will be a national group. Examples, RIA in America, Recording Industry Association of America, British Phonographic Industry, or ARIA in Australia. And these are national societies. For the sake of ease of doing business for the consumer, for the platforms, for the various touch points that require and use recorded music, governments globally, per a WIPO paper, have collection societies. So there's one collection society which deals with publishing, there's one collection society that deals with public performances. So 35,000 above feet level, that's the infographic that is there in the music ecosystem. There are collection societies for artists, for musicians, etc., but we'll get to that as the market develops. But I think Atul is in a better position to kind of carpaccio what the collection society is.
So who has to register with IPRS? Who has to register with
PP? Again, Rishi. So like I explained, just remember, there's a composition and lyric from where money needs to go to the composer and lyric writer. Any exploitation of that composition lyric means money has to go to the composer and lyric writer. Okay? This side, there's the sound recording. Any exploitation of sound recording means money has to go to the label and the artist. Okay? Now, the societies that are set up, it's very simple. A society is set up for collective licensing and collection because these are public performance societies. Essentially, they're set up for public performance, which means they license all shops, establishments, restaurants, hotels who play music. Now, as a composer, there's no way in hell KJ can even go to all the restaurants around his house which play music and collect from them. So you need a collective. That collective for the composers and lyric writers in India is called the IPRS. And there are equivalent bodies across the world. See, Indian Performing Rights Society. So they collect from establishments, they collect from television, they collect from radio, all of which is called public performance. When you're playing it on radio, it's going out to the public. When you're playing it on television, it's going to the public. When you're playing it in bars, clubs, and establishments, it's going to the public. That is for the composer and lyric writer. On this side, it is called the PPL. The Phonographic Performance Limited, because a record is called a phonogram. Nothing phonographic about it, sorry. So there is the PPL, which pays, collects and pays the record label and the artist. So it's only two. It's not confusing at all. You just have to keep remembering that there are two branches. Different people, they have to be paid separately, different collectives.
Now this is very, very important. If you're a filmmaker or if you're a composer, and all of you filmmakers in the audience will appreciate this, how does one value a piece of music? If I were a filmmaker and I liked a piece of music and I wanted it in my film, either as a background BGM, or I wanted a song, or I wanted something in my trailer or my promo, how am I to put value to that piece of music? And from a composer perspective, what would you like that value to be? I know you could say the sky is the limit, but I'm just saying, how does one evaluate that, Blaze, Atul, and KJ?
As with any creative work, it is what you put your value to that. And then with that, I would also say the market value which is going for that. For example, if I'm a producer, I have to evaluate whether I'm taking a risk on this new artist who nobody knows, and I'm giving him this kind of value, would I make enough returns on it? It's a purely a monetary thing. For the artist, it is, I have spent 1 year on it, and I think this is what I think I need to get paid for it. So on both sides, they are both evaluating what the actual rate is going to be. There is no fixed and hard and fast rule on this. The IPRS has gone and now put out rates, which tells you for existing creative work, how much would it cost to be used for a 30-second promo, for a trailer, for a film, if I'm right on that, Atul. So that would be using existing work. But for fresh composition, it's between you two to settle it out as to what is the best that you can get out of that. And you have to evaluate. If I'm giving away my rights, Atul and we were talking about this earlier, are you giving away your rights totally to somebody to exploit fully? Or are you going to keep some rights as a composer and just give it away, just let's say for a film? That means if you're going to do it for something else, take it away from the synchronized right and use it for something else. I've not given you permission for that. You can only use it for a film. So have I given you just that, or have I given you carte blanche? You can do whatever you want with it. So artists and composers, lyricists have to even look at that right now. Should I part away with it, the whole thing, give it to a publisher, or should I keep the whole thing myself? So those are issues which everybody is facing right now. And I think we are going through a very interesting and a nascent stage where things are coming together, whereby things are becoming more reachable, manageable. And I think that's a very good sign that everybody is kind of coming to the same platform.
Yeah. Atul and Blaze, I want to stick to film because it's film bazaar. So let's just talk about a value of a piece of music in a film, because then it will make sense to everybody who's in the audience. So from that perspective, please.
So it is complicated, but it's like peeling the onion. The record label has made an investment. The investment has gone idler in creating an artist, creating new talent. Just for the records, the global record industry is, every year the record industry spends $4.5 billion in what pharma industry calls research and development, what we call A&R. Okay? So they put that money out to develop new talent on a global basis. Here, it gets complicated because the record industry, the label is the front face of the negotiation. And therefore, it's unreasonable, very high, etc., etc. But if you kind of peel the onion, there are complications and there are layers. Very often, the record labels are hamstrung because there are certain groups, there are certain music bands, there are certain artists who do not want to kind of give their rights away. They're hamstrung. I think Queen is one of them. There are a couple of, you know, there are a couple of contractual obligations. The second is, what is the purpose of use? Alcoholic brands, how is it going to be used in the film, the creative sensitivity? Because don't forget, at the end of the day, the label is only the front, but there are many people who the labels have contracts with and contractual obligations. This is the global phenomenon. The third thing is the value. Please understand, the label has an input cost where he pays money upfront, either for the original soundtrack or for creating and developing an artist. And there's an output cost. Okay, so these are broadly the three or four layers that make it slightly difficult. But as I said, it's not impossible to work through a good deal with this, you know, if all the boxes are ticked. But these are the challenges some of the labels faces when kind of negotiating and licensing.
You know, Atul made a very, very important, very poignant statement last night when we were having dinner. And he said, you know, there is a song, let's say it's Churaliya. Now, Yashraj or a big studio, a Viacom 18 or this and that, wants that song. So you put an X cost on it. Suppose I'm a small independent filmmaker and I want Churaliya. For whatever reason, because it makes so much sense in my small, sweet little film. Can the owner of that piece of work, which in this case might be Churaliya, cost it for me at the same level that he's costing it for a Viacom or a Yashraj or a big studio house? And Atul, I'd like you to answer that.
Okay, so the first thing you have to remember is music, by law, is an exclusive copyright. Okay, which means that the owner has the power to determine the price. So I worked for a long time with Saregama and we started the whole publishing business and blah, blah. We've licensed songs. There was a television commercials were being made. So we used to get requests for TV commercials and with great difficulty, I'd got the rate up to 200,000 rupees for a sync, for a song. And then we appointed a sub-publisher in France and I got a mail saying that we are making a commercial for Peugeot, the 206 commercial, and we want 20 seconds of an Anand Shankar track, instrumental piece. So I drafted the mail saying that Gora, he's got money, so I'll charge 400,000 rupees. And then I said, hey, hang on a minute. Coming back to Cage's point, there is a relevance in that market, which I don't know sitting in India, so I handed it over to the publisher. The deal was closed at 320,000 euros. In those days, it was 1.65 crores. Okay, So left to me, I would have valued it at 4 lakhs of rupees. He valued it at 1.65 crores. The fact is that, so we are publishers, we deal with independent singer-songwriters. We don't get any requests from anybody to put that music in a film. Everybody runs to Saregama because they want Churaliya and they want, you know, the classic songs. If you have the money to buy a bicycle, please don't dream of a BMW. It's as simple as that. All right, that's the first thing. There is great music happening, and KJ works with a lot of independent artists. There is great music happening today. There's a lot of activity in the independent film scenario. There's great music. Don't be fixated about a song when you know you can't afford it, right? The way that we function as publishers, every publisher in the world will ask you what the budget of the film is. What is your production cost? All right?
That's
so they will quote you depending on your production cost. Why would I give Dharma Productions, Karan Johar's fancy big outfit, the same rate as I would give a student filmmaker? Why would I? I'd be nuts to do it. Ultimately, we are in business also. But there could be something where I say, listen, I don't want the deal to go. That's my philosophy. So I'll negotiate hard, but I won't let the deal go. Why should it go to somebody else? So if I'm asking, we licensed something for a podcast for 5,000 rupees the other day. The artist was laughing, saying that 5,000 bucks. But the fact is, I think it's the first time in India that a podcast is being licensed music. So the fact is that it is up to the owner of copyright to determine what that price is. It's up to him to say yes or no. Blaze just told you, try and get a Queen track into your film. I'm telling you today, it's not possible. So, you know, it is up to the owner. Like I said, exclusive right, I can determine the price. And I will always ask you, what's your production cost?
Fantastic.
Nobody has any money to pay for music. You don't mind paying Shah Rukh Khan, I don't know how many hundreds of crores or whatever it is, but there's never any money for music. And it's very pissing off when I own a right to the music. It's very pissing off for you to have someone come and tell you, you know what, I only have 20,000 rupees left for this song because I've paid Shah Rukh so much, I've paid Karan Johar so much, I've paid... I don't want to hear that. That's the last thing I want to hear. I'll never give you the song.
So two key takeaways. The production cost of your film kind of determines what you will be charged for a piece of music. And of course, the second very valid point that you made, saying if you have the budget for a cycle, don't dream of a BMW, which is equally true of the Churaliya example that I gave. Now, I want to come to another very important point, and this is from a composer's perspective. Often, musician friends of mine turn around and say, you know, there's a kid who came and said, I'm doing a student film. Give me this track free of cost. Documentary filmmaker comes to me and says, you know, give it to me at a nominal amount. And the next thing they know, that film has gone into the film festival circuit. And eventually it has gotten a foreign release or even a theatrical release in a lot of cases. And then the composer starts feeling a little shafted. KJ, has that ever happened with you? And, you know, if it's happened with friends, the fact, you know, that a cash-strapped independent filmmaker comes and asks for a certain amount of freebies, and then eventually it gets a theatrical release, then how does one deal or react to that situation?
See, the first reaction obviously is the one that you've been shafted. Yes, of course, that's the first gut reaction which comes to you. But I think it all depends on how your contracts, even though it's an independent filmmaker, I think it's important to have the contracts in place. Very, very important to remember that. If you don't have a contract, you have no right to even complain then, because you gave it all away. So put the contract in place that in case it goes over a particular threshold amount of money that it makes, I want to be making an X percentage more, or I'm okay with not making any money. So clear your intent right in the beginning. I think it's very, very important. And I've been talking to a lot of artists about this, that they need to put it on paper. So if both the sides have it on paper, I don't think there's anybody, there's no room left for any arbitration at all. So yes, it does feel bad because you've not thought about it that much ahead. So just think about it. The music business, something which me and Atul talk about a lot, is musicians are only interested in doing music. I think they need to learn the music business as well. Because if they start learning the music business, it'll be very easy to interface with any person, whether it's the film or whether it's their own career, anything. So this is part of the music business. That's why we are here. And that's why today, for the first time, NMDC is having a, you know, a seminar with all of us here about the music, because it's music business at the end of the day. So let's look at it from that point of view.
So I think just to add to what KJ was saying, when you want a piece of music for your films, the first thing is you have to be clear. You have to be clear as to what you want, because I will ask you the questions. I will say, is it going into film festivals? Is it going to go on television? Is it going to go here? Is it going to go there? And accordingly, I will charge my rate. So you have to be clear. Any publisher you go to will ask you to fill a form. What are you going to do with it? Where is it going to go? Be very clear about that.
This is a session for upcoming filmmakers. And I think important thing, whatever you create in terms of your final creative product, also keep in mind that there's an opportunity to monetize that. So I'm talking of the reverse now. So one is going and licensing a track, the other is creating your own music. Make sure it's published. Make sure you go to an aggregator. Maybe a label will find it very small, but today in the digital era, there are aggregators who take that music and probably try and do something for it. So look at it as a revenue stream. Don't only look at it as a cost center, but it also could be a revenue stream if you're looking outside. Lastly, given the fact that we have close to 250 labels, ensure that you have good research in your team, because there is repertoire available. You know, everybody looks at Churalia and looks at the big tracks, but there are tracks available in the regional area which can come for the price of that. You know, going back to the analogy of Mercedes-Benz versus this thing, there are tracks available. This is a huge market. There are 220 labels in India, and you probably look at it. So my advice is, look at it as a cost center, but also look at it as a profit center in terms of monetizing what you create. In case you're not licensing, make sure you have a good lawyer, make sure you're registered, make sure you have cue sheets. You know, tick all the boxes, make sure that you're registered with an aggregator globally as well as nationally.
Again, I'm going to troubleshoot now from a filmmaker's perspective. And if I was a filmmaker, if I was one amongst you sitting here, my logical question would be that if I identify a patch of music and I want it in my film, whether it's in background or if it's a song, can I use that also on my promos and trailers? Or am I not allowed to use it in my promos and trailers? So that's something we need a little bit of clarity on. Atul, can you take that?
Yeah, so again, like I said, if you tell me in advance what you're looking for, right, and my price is such, I may or may not. Normally, people do not allow you to use music in your promos and trailers, because they don't want your promo or trailer of a film which is not associated with that music to suddenly, for that music to suddenly be associated with that film. So classic example again is Queen. They don't want Queen's music associated with anything, right? So normally, a publisher would not allow you to use your music in trailers, to use his music in trailers. And if they do, they might give it at an additional cost. Because normally, also what happens is once it's come, then people remember, oh my God, I want to make a trailer using the music. Then they go back and they get charged again. That's why I said, if you're clear right from the start as to what you're looking for, it becomes much easier all around.
Okay. Now, I must confess that before I met these fine gentlemen, I didn't know the concept of a cue sheet in film in pure music terms. So I'd like them to actually break it down. What really is a cue sheet in film in musical terms? Yeah. And this is really, really important, because based on this cue sheet, a lot of the wheels are set into motion as far as publishing and, you know, the collection agencies are concerned.
Okay, so the first thing you have to remember is that the 2012 amendment to the law says that composers and lyric writers have to be paid, okay? And any filmmaker who does not make a cue sheet, because in the film, you're using background music and you're using songs. If you're not doing your cue sheets, you are party to breaking the law. I won't say you alone are breaking the law, but you're party to breaking the law. So the first thing as filmmakers, you must have a cue sheet. And a cue sheet is simply logging the time that music is played in the film, whether background or songs. So this time to this time dialogue, this time to this time this song, this time to this time background, and the names of the composers appear there. Those cue sheets are logged with the collecting societies, because when
television channels play your film, that cue sheet is the basis on which the collecting society collects and distributes the money to the composer and author, right? So your responsibility as filmmakers is definitely to get the cue sheets made, okay? And the composers also make the cue sheets. So filmmakers ask the composers to make the cue sheets, saying that, listen, you've done all the music, so you do it.
And especially regarding to film, because that's where the background score, film and television, is where broadcasting industry is where the background score actually comes into play, not in a regular song. So that's why cue sheets are important, and to know from which time to which time what music was played and who's the composer, to calculate basis the royalty on which it's based.
So all this data is ingested in the collection societies, who have now sophisticated proprietary software to track it in the outside world. What's playing on television, what's playing on radio, what's playing in a pub, and that data is then ingested and shares are distributed based on the tracking. And it's getting better by the day, with digital really leapfrogging the collection societies to the next level. So that's how the that's how the wheels work.
Okay, I'm going to again come back to the composer's angle of it. Two-pronged question. One, I'd like Atul to come in, because, you know, you actually gave, to give an example, perhaps of the Ram Sampath Tanha Dil peculiar case. And KJ, I'd like to ask you, is there a fear of signing with publishers, and are composers getting a feeling that they will become less favored with producers? That's what I want you to answer. And subsequently, Atul, as an offshoot of that, you know, you want to emphasize that the publisher doesn't become an owner, but becomes a licensee in these cases. So KJ, first.
I think I'll set the context first. So we'd done an album when I was at Virgin Records called Tanha Dil with an artist called Shan. The song was composed by Ram Sampath. And it became a hit, and I'd left Virgin. And then one day Ram called me and said, you know what, they've got my song remixed by someone without my permission, etc. So I'm not going to part with my copyrights in future. And I said, Ram, that's your prerogative. I said, but you know what, if you keep putting your copyrights in your pocket, you'll just end up with a very swollen pocket. That's it. What are you going to do with your rights? Don't you want to monetize them? So that was the context in which we had that conversation. And the idea, of course, is that all composers and writers should give their copyrights to a publisher, because there is ongoing exploitation that happens. And composers, being artistic by nature, will not really sit down and, you know, do the registrations with the societies. There's a lot of donkey work in publishing, which nobody likes to do. So, you know, that's the problem why people don't do it. But if they don't do it, they won't get paid. So
I think it's just lack of awareness about this with most composers. That, like I mentioned in the beginning, the exploitation word itself kind of has a certain connotation in everybody's mind. You know, when you use the word, I want to exploit your music, they feel they have to be exploited, as if I'm exploiting the artist. So I think those connotations, if they are cleared, will happen. And just to rephrase what Atul said, just as an example, when A.R. Rahman did Jai Ho, for example, he kept the rights of the film. He didn't give that away. And consequent to that, the Pussycat Dolls wanted to do a version of Jai Ho. And there was a Chinese pop artist who also did a version of Jai Ho. And I'm sure a large part of the money which went to paying his house in LA was that. So you see the potential of, if you give away your rights and you trust the publisher, suddenly takes on another facet altogether. You know, that's, you need to, as a musician and as a composer, I think they need to understand that. And that will come slowly as we are beginning to understand the whole cycle of the music business. That will start to happen slowly. Yes, of course, the publisher on the other end has to kind of give that confidence to the artist that I'm working for you, that I'm not going to kind of, you know, sell away your rights without telling you. That, of course, has to happen.
Yeah, so I think it boils down to, you know, what you said earlier about being clear about your contracts. Because there are two ways in which music is bought and sold. It's an assignment in which ownership changes hands, and there's a license. Okay, so if I'm a publisher, if I sign KJ as a composer tomorrow, he can either assign the rights to me, which is the trust factor, saying that, hey, listen, I know this guy's not going to rip me off, or he can say, I'm giving you an exclusive license under which I am still the owner. You cannot you know, go out and deal with it as though it's your property. And for any deals that you do, you have to clear them with me first. I mean, he doesn't want his music being put, let's say, in a porn film. As a businessman, I don't care. You know, I want the money. So we might have an arrangement where he is licensing it to me, or he could be assigning it to me. And to come back to the collecting societies, a lot of people, you know, ask a record label, when I'm paying you, why do I then need to take a license from IPRS, just for example, right? IPRS and PPM. The fact is that the label has already assigned the public performance right to the society. The label no longer owns it. They're not being difficult. They don't own that right anymore. If they were to sign that right to you, that will be illegal. They'll be breaking their own contract with IPRS. So the public performance right of all publisher members of an IPRS and public performance right of labels with PPL is already assigned to those societies. So as a filmmaker, you'll take the synchronization license, and then you'll find that there is, hey, hang on, there's an IPRS license to be taken as well. In some cases, it's a bit different there, but that is the law, and that is how the contracts operate. Once they've signed and assigned the rights to a collecting society, individually, they cannot deal with them.
Okay, before we go into audience questions, one last question to our panel. Key takeaway for me from this is that as a filmmaker, even if you're a small independent filmmaker, factor in the cost of your music, because that in effect could turn out to be your biggest asset. Even if you factor in a nominal cost, factor that in. A prime example, and I want to bring in web series here because we've only been talking about cinema. A friend of mine was a famous rapper, Vivian Divine. Viv did a song for the Sacred Games original motion, I shouldn't call it a motion picture soundtrack, but the web series soundtrack, which is Kaam Pachis Hai, Kaam Pachis Hai. And that song just completely blew up, isn't it? And in that aspect, there are going to be instances where if you actually factor in that cost, the sky is the limit for you. Atul.
Yeah, so, you know, like I said, don't come and tell me that, listen, I've already paid Saif Ali Khan so much money, so I have no money to pay you, so give me the song free. It doesn't work like that, right? And I think I'm coming back to Blaze's point, saying that when you take a license and you're creating an audiovisual piece of work, India is something that thrives on cinema, and today, call it a web series, call it whatever, India thrives on this. Okay, the people talking to me every day about, have you seen this on Netflix? Have you seen this on Amazon Prime? So there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of watching, viewership, and the music is valuable. Now, 9 times out of 10, the people who make these series and films, etc., don't release the music. Even if you're licensing the music, please understand the association or revival of a song or many songs is going to be associated with that latest film. That's when they remake songs and this Ghungru Toot Gaya is being, you know, associated with the new film, etc. You can even talk to the label, if you were to talk to a Saregama, saying that, hey, listen, guys, why don't you put out the song, repackage it as, I don't know, whatever it's called, Not So Sacred Games, etc., and put it out, right? They will get traction thanks to your movie, thanks to your web series. They will get traction. So I think it's very important that you look at it, as Rishi said, not just as a cost center. There's an opportunity here for you to make money as well. To Blaze's point about you're doing original, getting original music done, that's even better.
Okay, audience questions. We're going into our last 4 minutes. Vikram, please.
You know, the problem is, one of the challenges is that for independent filmmakers, they come from across the regions. So, say, let's take an hypothetical example of a Marathi film. Typically meant for festivals. The guy creates an original piece of music, or perhaps, say it's a violin piece with some tabla and some mridangam in it, or he takes it from a friend of his. Now, the point is that when the film goes its festival journey, and some of them do get theatrical, some don't, most of them don't, and then they hit the web OTT platforms now, how does one promote it? Now, Blaze talked about promoting it. Can you give specifics in terms of what should, because, you know, radio stations are not going to play it. I mean, maybe one Rishi Kannan, if he likes it and you pitch it to him, he's generous enough to do a show around it. But most of the radio radio stations are kind of playing, it's all plugged in and paid for, etc., etc. So in this world, how does that independent filmmaker who's weaved his music into the narrative is able to monetize it or promote it? Even if not monetized, at least it's promoted.
One small clarification. This word take, give, use the word contract. Okay? That will set the context for a lot of things going forward. You know, this len den, I've taken this, you've given that, contract it, because that's a IP you're creating property. Okay, keep that aside. Vikram, you've distributed films, I've distributed films, we've done that all our lives, and they were structured platforms, and today it's becoming even more difficult to promote film. But good creative content in the digital world is far easier to promote than in an era gone by when we distributed films. Festivals is one, social media is another, okay? And at the end of the day, things go viral today. So I think, you know, it's like surfing, surf with the tide, get your coordinates correct, and it is far easier to, you get lost in the cacophony, that's a different thing, but if content is good, it can travel globally.
Are there, I'm sorry, I thought you could add
no,
to
so
that.
I was just saying that, I always hear things with the, I hear music only, so if the question really was about music, just as you have a network and a formula for, let's say, promoting movies, you have the same for music. So we have our own distribution companies, we have our own PR people, social media people, etc., who will push the music. And actually, it's so much easier to push music than movies.
Is there an example that you have that you've worked with KJ's or a film that you've given music to that has gone that route and that you were involved in the promotions? A little bit of a concrete example, if you could put forward.
Like I gave, you know, I gave the example of the Secret Games song. So it was commissioned by them. It was.
Rishi, I'm talking about really indie films, you know. You know that. If there is an example there.
And I think aggregators also come into play here. Absolutely. You get into, you know, you get it to playlist on a Spotify or an Apple Music or a Savan, and you know slowly it starts lurking and it suddenly becomes sticky.
Yeah. So these platforms, the big thing now, and I always say this, you know, formats change, the business doesn't change. So what you used to get played repeatedly on radio at one time, it's about playlisting now. And everybody is very, you know, gung-ho about playlists and stuff. So it will find its own, as Blaise said, if the content is good, right, it's really going to get out there, and there is a whole system that promotes music.
Internally, get your paperwork right. Externally, make sure that you've given it out to the right people who you have a comfort, aggregators, distributors, labels, whatever you want.
Yes, sir.
So,
you.
Yeah. So my name is Jayant. I'm a filmmaker from Andhra. I made my first independent film, which is in Thenglish, Telugu and English. So for one of the sequences in my film, the couple would be sitting and watching something of Pulp Fiction movie, the dance sequence in the Pulp Fiction. And I would want that as the background score for this one. So this question is regarding the international music rights. So I actually tried to reach, people who are associated with getting their licenses in LA, because I couldn't find anyone who could help me in India as such. And then I was like bombed with the kind of cost they were talking about to get the licenses of those, music things. So my question is, like, is there anyone in India or any organization, something in India that we could reach to for, especially for such small independent films?
So actually we do it. Sorry, Blaise.
The cost is going to be the same, whether it's an Indian nation going to them or an international nation.
So again, it depends on usage and whom you're talking to, etc. So I don't know whom the music belonged to, but the majors, right? Universal Music Publishing, Sony ATV and Warner Chappell are represented in India. Cobalt is coming in January. So okay. The four largest music publishers in the world are going to be in India.
Okay.
So maybe that context changes then, because they will not be looking at it in dollar prices. It might become, you know, easier to do if you're talking to the representatives here.
So is there any website or anything which is listing all these things, or how do we go about
Take my card, I'll help you.
I'll tell you what, the way it happens is, the ideal situation is get a good agent to represent you,
An agent is normally a lawyer.
Okay.
Okay. And you kind of either do it in India, but Cobalt and all, everybody comes in there easier. Okay. But you still need, rather than focusing it on as a filmmaker, get a good agent, a good lawyer, and this person can kind of navigate you through the process.
Okay.
See, the difficulty everyone has is that there is no global database.
There is no global database. IMI deals. Okay. It's not a window.
Sir, I have one other question, if you don't mind. For example, if there is a song which is not famous out of like some country that I've listened to and I can't reach that person or there is no label which is representing it, and because I couldn't reach the artist for the rights, can I do a cover song of that song?
See you in Arthur Road Jail. That's the answer. You can't do it. It's intellectual property. It's like saying, I didn't know who the owner of the car was, I took the car.
Okay.
Sorry.
So there's a song by name Rockin' Robin, which is sung
by
Michael
Jackson. Specifics we'll talk offline.
Oh.
Yep.
Hi, sir. Very, very insightful, I must say. My question to Atul, sir, just to add this. When you say as the publisher of the owner, you would like to charge me according to my film's budget. But I was working on a film in which I had to use like 10 to 12 music pieces of different films from 60s and 70s owned by multiple publishers and labels. As an independent feature film, I was working on a very shoestring budget. But the quote I used to receive from multiple labels were in almost more than the 10 times of my entire film's budget. And nobody, believe me, nobody asked for my film's budget. So I'm sharing my experience. The question is that there are lots of stories we used to hear that you can use 10 seconds of your music piece without paying anything. So I'd like to get some clarity about that.
Yeah, so like I said, there's a car standing there. Don't steal the whole car. Just take the hubcaps and take the wheels. It's not stealing. No, not at all. It's intellectual property. You're filmmakers. How would you like if someone took 10 seconds of your film and put
Absolutely.
It in something else?
But as you said that you'd like to charge me according to my film's budget, but
so
I
listen,
make
one of the criteria. So
it's
not
the
criterion.
It's not the only criterion. People operate differently.
Yes, yes. But I went to multiple labels, but nobody asked me about my film's
budget. Don't complain to labels. Blaze will beat you up.
Or talk to Atul.
They're all friends of his.
Or talk to Atul.
Good afternoon, sir. I came from Bangladesh, actually. I have the opportunity to ask you. I face a crisis right now. I'm doing a documentary film on a particular refugee in the Rohingya camp. He's a musician, actually, and he composes music because he's illiterate. He composes music orally and play it to his own community. But the thing is, when I'm documenting on him, and I had a pitch in the international platform last year, this year, August, I was asked by a foreign mentor that did you had the rights of the rights of his music to show it in your documentary film or that? So I said no, I didn't, because I'm doing the documentary on him and he is a musician. That's my key point, and I should use his music in the documentary for the 70-minute feature. So what should I do? But because he is illiterate and he is a refugee in the Bangladesh camp. There is no particular solution in my country in that way. So actually in that situation, how can I get the rights?
Get a lawyer, tell him to draft a contract under which the composer will license his work to you for putting in your film.
Yeah.
But do it. Without that, you won't be able to exploit.
Somebody can read that contract to him and explain to him what it is so that he knows what he's signing.
Yeah,
but you will need, irrespective of whoever the artist is, and even if you are making a film on that artist, once you've recorded it, either on for audio or for film or for tele, anything for broadcasting, if you've recorded, you will need their permission because it's their work. They've created it for you, but it's still their work.
No, and without a license, international markets won't touch you.
Okay, that's all we have time for. KJ, Atul, Blaze, thank you very much. And a big shout out to Vikramjit Roy, Lancey, and the entire team at Film Bazaar to include music in film, and we hope it's a regular feature as people who are invested very heavily in the music business. Thank
you
very much.
When you came in, Vikram, I said Film Bazaar has come a long way. The states are participating, an old dream come true, single window clearance. But Goa has a siesta time in the afternoon. Keep that in mind.
Thank you